It is now my pleasure to welcome this morning's featured speaker. Dr. Vejas Liulevicius specializes in modern German history. I love that you just nodded to that. Thank you. I practiced.
It was beautiful.
Thank you. Thank you. Not only being gracious, but he is a scholar with a particular focus on German relations with Eastern Europe. He completed his PhD at the University of Pennsylvania and was a postdoctoral research fellow at the Hoover Institute on War, Peace, and Revolution. He has taught at the University of Tennessee since 1995 and since 2008, has served as the director of a Center for the Study of War and Society. His authored works include War, Land on the Eastern Front, Culture, National Identity, and German Occupation in World War I, and The German Myth of the East, 1800 to the Present. In 2004, one of Germany's main magazines published an invited article by Dr. Liulevicius entitled The Poisoned Victory, How the First World War in the East Shaped Hitler's Murderous Worldview. Dr. Liulevicius joins us today to discuss the Eastern Front experience in the First World War, and we are delighted to have him. Please join me in welcoming him to the podium.
It's a great delight to be here today, and I think the very most appropriate place for all of us to start in the good spirit that has obtained in this conference is to, first of all, to thank very, very effusively the organizers of this conference, the tremendous work of Laura Vogt and of Denise Rendina. Could you join me, please, in a round of applause for them? Thank you. Now, I do have to say that judging by today's weather, this is exactly the right setting in which to discuss the Eastern Front. I wish that it wasn't, but there it is. To a very great extent, the First World War on the Eastern Front remains for general historical consciousness pretty much what Winston Churchill called it back in 1931, the unknown war. Contrast how present in our minds today are the trenches and bunkers of the Western Front, and how, by contrast, unfamiliar are the spaces of Eastern Europe. And in that spirit, let me put one of those spaces up on the board. Today, I'd like to discuss the great significance of the Eastern Front and what it meant in human terms, and indeed in terms of its global significance. In the European context, three empires came crashing down as a result of this conflict: the Russian, Austro-Hungarian, and German empires, and they had clashed in titanic scale in Eastern Europe. Many Americans have background as the children or descendants of immigrants from Central and Eastern Europe, and that's witnessed by the names that one sees throughout the exhibition of this wonderful museum. It's this war which saw the establishment of independent nations in that part of the world out of the wreckage of those former empires. The resurrection of Poland, the establishment of independent Baltic states, Finland, Czechoslovakia. So if the 20th century has been marked by the crash and demise of empires and of decolonization, an important milestone took place here on the Eastern Front of World War I, and its world significance is clear. What I'd like to share with you today are some thoughts on what the Eastern Front experience meant for those who lived through it. Now, ancestors of mine in Lithuania were civilians who experienced the war, and they experienced it as the objects of that war, as the front moved through and as occupation commenced. But my own scholarly work as a historian has focused on another group of people, the German soldiers who found themselves in these wide open Eastern European spaces. And I have sought to ask, what was their experience? Or even more simply, what did they think they were doing there so far from home? On the Eastern Front in World War I, ordinary German soldiers experienced in many ways a war of movement, while their comrades in the Western trenches of Flanders and elsewhere instead were sinking into a stationary war of position, in German Stellungskrieg. In the literal sense of a war of movement, or Bewegungskrieg, in Eastern Europe, however, the potential for strategic breakthroughs seemed more plausible than on the Western Front, in those wide open spaces of the great Northern European plain. The decisive battle that would end the war eluded German generals as Russian forces were able to withdraw further east. Now, it has to be said, obviously, there was trench warfare and warfare of position on the Eastern Front as well, but there were spasmodic moments in 1914, 1915, 1917, and then especially in 1918, of vast movement on the Eastern Front. At the same time, Eastern Europe also saw a war of movement in the subjective sense, as individual German soldiers experienced passage across vast distances and into unfamiliar landscapes. The Eastern Front extended for 1,000 miles, twice the length of the Western Front, and behind it lay enormous occupied areas. Soldiers advancing into enemy territory on the borderlands of the Russian Empire traveled to regions that were often, for them, unfamiliar and strange, and encountered firsthand largely unknown lands and people. Such developments constituted a very important part of the total war experience for masses of men. During the course of the First World War, some 2 to 3 million German soldiers served on the Eastern Front, and on average, 1.3 million were serving in the East each year of the war. Today, I in essence want to argue that three very important things happened on the Eastern Front during the First World War. First, the initial experiences for German soldiers of the first advance into the Russian Empire would be decisive. These were durable first impressions that set many of the terms of the continuing German encounter with the East during wartime. The area would seem to them a war land, Kriegsland, a place set apart, where increasingly scenes of devastation seemed normal, the default mode. Second, I will argue, in a development that followed the experience of invasion, geographies of ambition and anxiety would be articulated by German military authorities and ordinary soldiers alike. These mental mappings, we could call them, deserve close attention because they discover for us a complex mixture of attraction and repulsion, which the East evoked in the occupiers, a tension that was, watch the quotation marks, resolved in the idea of a civilizing mission of German culture in the East, with the Germans understanding themselves very often as modernizers and bringers of culture. And the third development, and this was fateful, the experience of German occupation moved, or in many cases forced, many Eastern European civilians to press for independence, to welcome effusively, when it was announced, Woodrow Wilson's very American message of self-determination and the rights of small nations. Because foreign imperial rule, whether Russian or German or Austro-Hungarian, had been so discredited by the crisis of the Great War. So generalizations about the experiences of millions of men on the Eastern Front need to be derived from a whole range of sources. But for today, I want to bring it down to the individual human level and to focus on the testimony of one man who, in his account, summed up themes eloquently that show up in many other accounts. This source is the wartime journal of a young man, and I wish that I had his photograph, but this is the problem of historians with sources. No photograph is available. He was a young man by the name of Josef Wenzler, who published a wartime journal in 1918 that was entitled Mit Draht und Kabel im Osten, with wire and cable in the East, from the diary of a telegrapher. Wenzler was an ordinary young man from Karlsruhe who was sent to the Eastern Front in 1914, and he loved his experience because he saw himself as a telegraph troop, that's to say someone who was extending wires in order to facilitate communication, as a modernizer, someone who was changing the face of war and making it manageable in modern ways. He even referred to himself and his colleagues as Blitzjungen, that's to say lightning boys, which sounds like a superhero of some sort. Well, what did such men experience? The Great War began with surprises for Germany in 1914. As the Schlieffenplan's formula for quick victory in the West was foiled, and dramatic, terrible reverses played themselves out in the East, because fast Russian mobilization and Russian attack on East Prussia produced a crisis for German military and political leaders. However, in an almost miraculous development, Russian forces were repulsed by men who were acclaimed as saviors, von Hindenburg and Ludendorff. The trauma of Russian invasion of East Prussia onto German territory would be carefully, indeed lovingly, cultivated by German government propaganda in the following years, because it was used to create an image of mass devastation and Russian abuses against German civilians that was used to cement the social truce of 1914 within Germany, as we heard last night in Michael Nyberg's talk. In the next year, in 1915, however, with Russian forces expelled from the territory of the Reich, German armies went over to the attack, and in quick succession, they conquered vast territories that comprised Russia's northwestern area, Lithuania, Courland, that's to say southern Latvia today, and Poland. By the fall of 1915, German forces stood deep in enemy territory, and this advance would be remembered in epic terms as the Great Advance of 1915. Josef Wenzler's account of the experience of moving into the spaces of the Russian Empire conveyed an epic scale. To him, the advance seemed elemental, potentially never ending, a kind of almost physical onward rushing towards victory. And he was struck by the fact that the Russians that he was seeing as soldiers were not victorious Russians, but masses, faceless masses of columns of Russian POWs being moved to the rear. The Germans, it seemed to him, were characterized by constantly moving forward. They never say, there are the Russians, but the Russians are still there and we're going to attack and move them out. Wenzler was not the only one who felt this way. In soldiers' newspapers of the Eastern Front, the memory of this great advance of 1915 was even summed up in some epically horrible poetry that I want to share with you. This poem is entitled On the Advance March, and it starts like this. Like a dark gray coat, the heavy night lowers itself. Without respite, restless, ever further, eastwards we carry the battle. The smell of burning and rubble and corpses. Pestilence is in every pull of breath. And with wild greed, a vulture breaks out of the dark realm of clouds. Horror and terror lie over the blood-soaked field. Let it lie, let it be. Battle is battle and war is war. Cheerful and without respite, restless, eastwards we carry victory. I had warned you that it was bad. This would be a durable memory from the start of the World War. As German soldiers contended with the necessities then of administering these vast spaces they seized, for many of them, the first impressions were crucial. They lacked often detailed familiarity with the lands and peoples of the regions that they moved into. Even soldiers who lived in the eastern parts of Germany sometimes confessed that it was a new world to them. Let me give you one example. A man who later went on to be a famous sociologist, but at this point was one of the telegraph troops that Wenzler considered his comrades, was Norbert Elias, who afterwards recalled that even though he lived in Breslau in the east, he had only the vaguest notions of a despotic Russia over there. The generalizations which German soldiers arrived at, however, were not created in a mental vacuum. Their observations linked to earlier stereotypes of Slavic peoples in Eastern Europe that had been current in German culture from the 19th century or even before. These included notions of a so-called cultural gradient or Kulturgefälle, which was supposed to reach its peaks in Germany and slide down into barbarism the further one went into Eastern Europe. Or the notorious notion of Polish economy, Polnische Wirtschaft, a sort of a synonym for Eastern Europeans and especially Poles' alleged inability to organize themselves, a synonym for chaos, essentially. In the propaganda of the ideas of 1914, Germany was said to be locked in a global contest to defend its culture against the fake and artificial civilization of the Western Allies and against the sheer Unkultur, or unculture, of Eastern Europe. Such predispositions would now be attached to the first impressions that soldiers formed of these spaces. The most common observations centered on the destruction that the Russian forces had imposed upon the area in a scorched earth policy as they retreated, or as the front passed through. But in propaganda, it was always Russian scorched earth policy that was preferred as a plausible explanation. Soldiers also noted, to their eyes, the primitiveness of native populations in their towns, the poor quality of roads and other transport, and especially the wide open spaces of the steppe-like plains and an allegedly untamed wild nature. In the process of observing the region, few allowances were made for the fact that a lot of these conditions had everything to do with the fact that the front had just passed through. Instead, they were seen as somehow intrinsic to these territories, this place and these people. Russian scorched earth policy was held up in particular as an indictment of the enemy as someone who was not capable of maintaining order. The damage to railroads, bridges, infrastructure, and homes was intended to hold up the German advance. In East Prussia, Russian troops had been charged with similar senseless destruction, an expression of anarchy, as a kind of rampage. And this was said to be a characteristic kind of behavior that those people, the Russian forces, continued on their home territory. It was argued that by doing so, they lost their claim to these lands. Moreover, the territory seemed conspicuously empty. Roughly a third of the population of civilians had fled as the front moved in. And in fact, in southern Latvia, it was over 50% had fled. So an impression of emptiness was certainly the order of the day. Wenzler cataloged his impressions at an early point. Let me just read you this quote. "A disconsolate and dirty plain, burned out villages, a village of ruins, darkness, rainfall, smell of burning, distant barking of a dog, wind howling, dull infantry fire, tired bones, dismay, and hunger. These were lands of war." In the advance, German soldiers also remarked on the actual experience of crossing over the border into the Russian Empire, into Feindesland, or enemy land, which seemed to them almost a kind of a civilizational boundary. In all of these impressions, a crucial first impression was that of dirtiness. Now, obviously, dirtiness was to be found on the Western Front. That's a beautiful understatement. And yet here, it was given a particular ideological charge. Dirtiness was a crucial part of the first impression. In one high-flying prose passage, Wenzler waxed lyrical on the sheer depressing impact of it all on seeing his first Russian village. This is actually in Poland, so it's not a Russian village. But see, as I read you the quote, whether you can spot the emerging theme. "We wind our way forward and finally glimpse the first Russian village, Vyshyny, rising up dirty gray. The German term is schmutzig grau. Before us, above the clay gray region, above it stares the dirty gray sky, as if hung with sackcloth. And dirty gray is the huge mass of thousands of Russian prisoners that rolls toward us through the village. Gray is the whole picture which unfolds itself. Gray, the new impression that Russia has given us. Gray and obscured is the fate of the next days. All gray, dirty gray. The people of the region, especially miserable refugees, were likewise seen as somehow fundamentally unclean and potentially dangerous carriers of diseases." Here from a collection of wartime souvenir photographs is a scene that we don't really know exactly what it represents, but it's entitled in German, Kaufverhandlung um ein schmutziges Brot, a bargaining for a dirty piece of bread. And here is a destitute, probably homeless man who's surrounded by German soldiers, and it's an encounter, a first encounter, speaks to some of these themes of a civilizational divide. Over time, as it became clearer to the German military administration that they found themselves not in one uniform Russian empire, but rather in a remarkably mixed ethnic patchwork of peoples who were not all Russian, the awareness grew that these areas had to be administered in ways that would exploit the opportunities of the situation. If this was not Russian area, ethnically, that it might as well be administered and ruled by a German outside force as an outside Russian force. In this event, the slogan that was crucial was German work. The notion that German administrative talent and organization would direct the scattered and up to this point unproductive efforts of the small non-Russian peoples of this region. Under the circumstances, the constant stress on everything being unfamiliar may not have been true of all German soldiers. Some of them had experience of the Russian Empire in these lands. And yet, the continued stress that it was unfamiliar might have ideologically allowed German administrators to say, we're starting from nothing. We're starting without a prior template. I want next to discuss a little more about the character of the strange state that was established in the northeastern part of the Eastern Front Zone. While a civilian administration of occupation was established in Poland, a strange military state by the name of Oberost came into existence in what is today Latvia, Lithuania, and parts of Poland and Belarus. It took its name from General Hindenburg's title as Der Oberbefehlshaber Ost, the Supreme Commander of the East, and it constituted what amounted to a military utopia, a chance for the army to prove itself as an administrator, as a creative force, drawing on earlier German tradition. Aiming to establish facts on the ground and to claim the future of this region as a result, the Oberost state energetically sought to control in a really total and comprehensive way the people and economic resources of the region. And it spent, in the context of war, an astonishing amount of resources and energy on cultural programs that were meant to manipulate the ethnic identities of the minorities living in this region. Lithuanians, Jews, Poles, Latvians, Belarusians, Estonians, Ukrainians, even Tatars, and other smaller minorities. As the idea of German work suggested, German experts and administrators were to rule over these people in a neutral way, coordinating and cultivating them from above. And I should note a fascinating gendered aspect to all this. The military state was completely male because Ludendorff explicitly forbade wives of military men following them to the occupied territory. It was supposed to be an experiment of sorts. The occupation regime sought to control and direct all movement in the area through a range of strategies that were called by Verkehrspolitik, essentially movement policy. Natives were issued passes, and their movement was strictly controlled. They were not allowed to cross severe boundaries between administrative divisions. Censuses were undertaken to try to pin down the often elusive question of just what the ethnic identity of a region was. There were reams of regulations on what one could do or not do economically that were published in order to direct all of the economic resources and harvests of the region to the state's machinery. As a positive measure for the transformation of the occupied territory, roads and telegraph lines and railroads were also built up on the assumption, as Sophie pointed out yesterday, that these territories would thus have a claim, a German claim, to disposition of their future. But there were also anxieties, deep anxieties, involving epidemics that might arise in this region. The area was quarantined and shut off so that diseases would not spread back to Germany. The locals were vaccinated, sometimes with the use of compulsion. And the hygiene of German soldiers, here you see a public bath in Lithuania, a military public bath, was taken as tremendously important. Moreover, when soldiers went back to Germany on leave, they were subjected to a very important measure at the border, delousing at a special station so they could continue their home journey uninfected by the dangers of the East. Also, over time, particular ambitions and anxieties rose up about the occupied territory. On the one hand, there was the hope that out in the East, the soldiers themselves might somehow be forged onto a new model of Germanness, that they might perfect a better model of German community than had obtained in the previous decades in an often fragmented and socially divided German empire. This isn't a uniquely German theme. Just think of all of those World War II movies with bomber crews where one guy has to come from New York, the other has to be from the South, yet another has to be from the Midwest, and they all come to know one another and become Americans. Well, so here too, Germans from different regions mixing were supposed to be producing a new German national identity. On the other side of this coin, however, there was the fear of being absorbed into the alterity, the foreignness of these regions, an erosion of manners, and essentially a kind of going native. And an answer was to create as many as possible installations of Germanness, like reading rooms or soldiers' homes in the unfamiliar spaces of the East. I want to conclude by talking about what happens on a higher ideological plane. What sort of ambitions begin to obtain for the future? The propaganda of the Oberostate also suggested that a reinforced German national identity in these foreign lands would have a special role, the bringing of a cultural or civilizing mission to the East, here depicted in allegorical form by a German soldier with a helmet sowing seeds in what earlier, the implication is, had been neglected and unproductive territory. I should note that I don't think that this was a universal sentiment on the part of ordinary German soldiers. Most of them were simply homesick and wanted to go back to peacetime, to other existences, and were not longing for estates in Eastern Europe. But they were crucial members of the elites and the officer class who certainly did hold these more expansive ideas. The Oberostate invested a lot of time in preparing for a future of tutelage of this region. It published newspapers in native languages. It crafted special vocabularies, sometimes in those languages, in order to communicate orders. Get this. Army theater reviewers actually evaluated native drama performances. Army scholars, in the context of total war, spent time poring through archives and even launching archaeological excavations as a way of showing that they could expose the true histories of these lands. The slogans of German work and culture were expressed in two ways that I find especially vivid. Here's a German propaganda postcard showing boys on the Eastern Front getting a haircut from German soldiers, and watch what the label is, Deutsche Kultur, German culture. And I can't resist subjecting you to one more horrible poem. It's by an amateur poet from the ranks, a sergeant by the name of Hamm, and I've heard from veteran friends of mine that all sergeants are philosophers or comedians, or often both, and that's maybe the case here. His poem was entitled A Look Backwards. Even still I hear the pounding of heavy steps in the rubble of the cities, hear people pleading, villages moaning, condemned to death in flames. All about my eyes still see the misery which the disgrace of the Russian army inflicted on their own land, on works of nature. But that which seemed forever lost was created anew by the German battalions of Kultur. Many thousands of hands, there's more, many thousands of hands I see serving duty. The German spirit blows through the poor land, and new life rises out of the ruins which noble minds snatched from decline. The golden bridge of the future is erected, waiting for the spring, field and meadow breathe. We have carried eastward stone upon stone, we German pioneers of Kultur. Now, these notions were also projected homewards to Germany. We could talk more about that in the question and answer in really a vast propaganda effort. But it's precisely here that we need to indicate a larger paradox. It was just at this moment of German triumph when the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk imposed upon a prostrate Russia in the grip of the Bolshevik regime, just when it seemed that the victory that all this propaganda talked about had been achieved, it was at that point, and in fact due to the severities of German policies and economic exploitation in the occupied areas, that a whole range of movements for national independence took hold among Eastern European peoples. In part, this was a generational phenomenon. A whole young generation of young people felt that something decisive had to be done to avert a future they saw emerging that didn't look desirable. And there's one quote from a Lithuanian nationalist that I think sums this up eloquently. He talks about a breaking point around 1917 in which, quote, we finally felt this servitude to be unbearable. It's as if at some culminating point was reached by about 1917 or 1918. So, in conclusion, during the course of the First World War and its aftermath, an important transition in German views of the East had taken place. A trajectory can be traced. At the start of the occupation, there's a new recognition that what seemed like a monolithic Russia was actually a complicated mosaic of distinct lands and peoples. But by the war's end, after ambitious propaganda about what the future might hold in this sort of tabula rasa, this blank slate, increasingly Eastern Europe came to be seen not in terms of diverse peoples and places, but instead in terms of spaces and races. The term that was used was Raum und Volk. And not coincidentally, this would be a term that the Nazis would later take up in their far more brutal, immeasurably more brutal policies in Eastern Europe as well. One can actually detect this shift in Wenzler's writing. At first, he carefully notes down the names of the villages he passes through. And then towards the end, he says, we pass through the village of Z, or something like that, of middle size, as dirty and bumpy as all the other villages. So finally, there's an exhaustion, a sense that it's all a blur and monolithic all the same. At the end of the war, parts of the mental mapping of Eastern Europe as a conquered zone collapsed with German defeat and was replaced by anxieties about what an advancing Eastern Europe might look like. The distance that earlier had been maintained between the homeland and the occupied territories fell away, and fears grew of the Bolshevik regime and communism advancing out of Russia on Germany, or of what were called Russian conditions now coming home to roost in Germany as well. This recruiting poster for the Freikorps, the German mercenaries who went on what is really only possible to call sort of a tourism of violence in the eastern borderlands for a year after the alleged end of the war, only ending in about December of 1919, speaks to these anxieties. These experiences would be a crucial part of the overall Eastern Front experience. And the Nazis, who had returned to Eastern Europe in World War II, would continue the radicalization that we've charted. One part of their agenda, obviously, was racial murder, genocide, as they called it, the final solution to the Jewish question, end quote. The other part of the agenda was expansion in Eastern Europe, in spaces that an earlier generation had visited. The Eastern Front experience, thus, had global legacies. On the one hand, altered German views of the East would form an important and in many ways devastating legacy for decades to come. On the other hand, German occupation and then the crash of empires encouraged Eastern Europeans to seek independence. And in the West, in Western Europe, we have tropes of the meaninglessness of the slaughter. In Eastern Europe, this is often celebrated not as an experience that wasn't sorrowful and dreadful, but as a entryway, a baptism of fire that led to national independence. Both of these trends had vast consequences with global reverberations, and they came out of the First World War. Thank you very much. I will do so. Here and then next here, please.
Can you go back to your map, please?
Absolutely. This one?
Was there any plans for the division of that area between Germany and Austria-Hungary?
Well, the Ukraine, for instance, which is seized in the course of a true war of movement, one that astonishes even the German generals who say they've never seen anything like this, German troops moving forward by railroad into these open spaces. The same is true of the Austro-Hungarians, and there is a division into occupation zones. Obviously, they're not there long enough to really do much more than to be tremendously disappointed. And what I mean by that is this seemed to be the master stroke that would solve Germany's provisioning problem. This, after all, is an area known as the breadbasket of Europe. The reality, however, was a dreadful irony, a paradox. In order to extract those resources, the grain harvests, meant that the Germans had to retain about 1 million men in these vast open spaces. And some military historians have argued that the not being able to use those reserves in the last offensive in the spring in the West could have been decisive. So there's a case of exalted plans for solving the problem of the war and carving out empire in the East not coming to fruition. And the Austro-Hungarians were just as much, if not more, disappointed than the Germans by this course of events, because Austro-Hungary is starving at this point. So the short answer is that the plans don't advance very far. I get the sense of reading in the Austro-Hungarian sources that there's a sense of almost hopeless improvisation at this point. That's how dire the situation is. Thank you. Please.
I'll stand up so people can hear me. I'm fascinated, David, by your emphasis on the experience of a single soldier. And I'm wondering about the extent to which Wenzler's views might have been affected by his own social background and own political views. I ask this question because I also have an Eastern Front soldier. My Eastern Front soldier was a man named Ernst Reuter, about whom I wrote a biography a few years ago, who after 1945 became the legendary mayor of West Berlin, the mentor of people like Willy Brandt and so on. But he served for 2 years on the Eastern Front. And for him, as going into the war as a social democrat, the experience on the Eastern Front had a politically radicalizing effect, especially after he was taken prisoner. He was a POW for 2 years, and then after the Bolshevik Revolution, even before Brest-Litovsk, he's involved with lots of other German POWs in an organization called War Prisoner Internationalists, Kriegsgefangene Internationalisten. And so his experience is conversion to Bolshevism and return to Germany as a convinced communist. And so I'm wondering if you could perhaps say something about the way in which, beginning with Wenzler, the actual backgrounds of German soldiers might have affected their perceptions.
Thank you. That's an excellent question. I'll just repeat it for the benefit of the camera. In brief, the question is, what prior experiences or orientations German soldiers serving in the East brought to their experience? And you have an Eastern Front soldier. I have an Eastern Front soldier here today. As many men as there were, obviously, that's how many experiences and trajectories there were. And what strikes me is their sheer diversity. You're quite right to be sensitive that Wenzler's account is that of a middle-class young man from an educated German background, a former university student who is located probably somewhere on the national liberal part of the spectrum. And he cleaves to many of those views throughout. What's striking is that in reading his account, my sense is that the politics are not front and center. It's the immediacy of the scenes that he's seeing that that are in the foreground rather than sort of a comprehensive articulated political program. But for every example of a soldier who arrived as a social democrat or as an ardent nationalist, there are others who felt themselves transformed by the war experience. And what strikes me, and I developed this much more fully in my book that would direct anyone who might be interested further, what really strikes me is how, on the one hand, you have a project of incorporating new territory, and in the case of Oberost, modeling new forms of rule that, to me, are bound up with the experience of total war, this ambition of total rule and total extraction. And yet, even among some of the officers who have to fulfill the orders of this regime, what strikes me is, independent of any one political affiliation, how many there are who say, I don't want to be a part of this. And military discipline being what it is, they're not able to speak out against it in sort of a here I stand and I cannot do otherwise spirit. But at the same time, they express misgivings and doubts and criticism of the authorities, of what's being done in the name of a machinery that they're part of. And for every experience of someone like Wenzler, who arrives interested in the diversity and then over time is simply exhausted by it, there are other soldiers who are fascinated by, just as a for instance, the Eastern European Jewish communities, with whom, as opposed to most of the other nationalities, they can actually communicate a little bit through Yiddish, cognate to their German. I mean, they're able, with this one ethnic group, to come into relations. And it's a fascinating range of reactions to the Jewish communities as well. There are Germans who are ferocious anti-Semites, who arrive and see the conditions, the war-affected conditions of the Jewish communities, and say, look at the condition of these people. This is what the anti-Semitic journals have been saying all along. And yet others, especially German Jewish soldiers, who discover a whole new dimension to themselves as a result of this encounter. So it's the sheer variety also the mutability in conditions of war that really strike me in so many of these cases. Thank you, please.
First of all, it's nice to meet you in person because I, of course, have read all your publications. That's one of the advantages, I think, of these conferences. I did some research on the war aims of Saxony, which only was possible after the unification, because before you couldn't get to the archives. Now, what we all maybe made a mistake at when we were doing research on German war aims, we looked at the central government. Instead of looking at, it's a federal government, and you have, you know, for example, Bavaria, after 4 days of the war, the king of Bavaria wants Alsace and Lothringia, they all think about what are we getting out of it after the war is over. 15 is a highlight of the Saxony's king to think, what are we going to win? And they want Lithuania, and they do send their civil servants there, they do make sure there's commanding officers of the Saxon army there, and it should be a place, you know, for a new Fürstentum in this area. And what struck me was what was behind it. First of all, they were offered parts of Poland. They said, no, it's too Jewish, not our kind. So they said, but Lithuania is different, and there was agriculture, that was an attractive thing. Of course, it was in 15, and the advance was fast. So they were dreaming of actually taking everything. And then it turns out, all of a sudden, you don't have a central government. You have rivalries. You have the Prussians, who want the same area. And the Bavarians, or Oldenburg, they also say, we should have a part there too. So all of a sudden, you see the central government is not controlling any longer the war aims. Because now these different states of Germany and the different nobilities, they come up with their claims in Belgium, wherever. And much of interest of Saxony went, you know, to Lithuania. It was a promising future for agriculture. They were lacking this, they had lots of industry, but agriculture was a problem. So it is nice. And what I actually want to encourage you is we should stop looking at Beckmann Hollweg's war aims of September 14. All these nobilities and all these kings had made their own war aims before already. They saw where am I getting something out of the whole thing that's striking sometimes? The ideas they had, what they would get after the end of the war, which of course the Germans would be winning easily as all wars.
Could I summarize and add one sentence? The very valuable point here was about how it's not just the Reich level government that is setting war aims, but there's also a lower level of the individual principalities of Germany that are also sort of putting in their orders. It's as if there were an Amazon.com and there's a shopping cart, and they're moving territories in. I think that's a marvelously important emphasis, because it even goes further down. Cities in Germany, not even territory, but cities start sending out feelers about how it might be possible in future to have territories in the East. And in the case of individual officers, this anecdote comes quite often, that individual officers who are passing through Poland or Lithuania are kind of noting down for themselves, this is a very nice region right here, and wouldn't it be nice to settle here after the war? What I think that the reason this is important is because it speaks to issues that we've talked about in this conference. What's the individual motivation? And in the case of those principalities or of cities, not so much in the case of officers looking for estates, but in the case of people at home, you can be an annexationist without wanting to move there yourself. And I think that's what makes this mixture so volatile, is people can sign on to imperialism without volunteering to make the move themselves. And it can still be a toxic legacy. Thank you.
If you have more questions, please. Vejas will be here the rest of the day, to the end. So